online and one-on-one coaching. Mr. USA 2001, Quincy Taylor. 4 times Mr. Olympia athlete. Show preparation and general fitness. 30 years of experience. Bring out your monster. NYTEQT1@gmail.com. At Quincy.monster.
I eat 300-pound bodybuilders for breakfast! Wow, what is this, mango? Now, how long is this supposed to take? Here it comes! Oh, wow! It's still coming!
We're back without an intro, without my great intro. Without Tyler's great intro. I have Mr. G with me here in the studio, guys, for another exciting episode here of After Hours. We got our great panel today, John Romano, Greg Valentino, Johnny Bravo, and Big Rob. And Mr. G brought me the new protein bagel that you have coached him on how to make, and he even made protein cream cheese for it.
And here you go.
I want to tell you, it tastes just like a real bagel. I can't decipher it from like something I get at the bagel store.
Good.
Panera, a real Jewish place, does it taste like a real bagel place or Panera?
Yeah, no, he nailed it. He got the bagel recipe right, finally.
That's good awesome. Job, Georgie.
With protein.
Hey, can I just ask you a question?
Yes.
How come when I take Fiberlite and I shit, the lights don't flicker or
turn on? I want to know how come when I pound on the sink, the drawer don't open.
You're not Jimmy the Bull.
Is it the fucking cowboy boots he was wearing, or is it
what it is?
Am I doing something wrong?
Jimmy's got magic in those fists. That's what it is. Now,
Mr. G, I thank you. He sent me a care package, a bunch of cookies, Reese's peanut, Reese's pieces that he makes out of the protein.
Buttercups.
Let me tell you guys, I ate it myself. Phenomenal.
Really?
And I'm
amazing.
Not even around. So, Mr. G, thank you so much for that. And I want to make sure people know that your shit is good because Lenny shitted on it last time.
Yeah.
So thank you.
No, it's awesome. Yeah. I had it too, John. It is amazing.
Yeah, the peanut butter cup. Means nothing because everything is good
now
to
what,
you.
What's this one I have here? Is this the Lee Priest cookie?
No, that's the Lee Priest is a grim.
So he made the Lee Priest cookie in a keto version, which is like only less than 4 grams of carbs.
That's cool. Pistachios.
That's good.
Yeah, that's good. So that's like that's more like an Italian cookie because
it
not
tastes
like
a. What are those cookies? The Italian cookies.
Pignolia.
Yes. Unbelievable. How'd you do that?
That's got pistachio pudding, pistachios in it.
This might be your best cookie.
It's made with almond flour. You know,
it tastes like when you would go to Christmas, you probably made these things. What? It's unbelievable. It's really good.
Good.
Well, John knows.
I think he told me that one. I didn't.
No,
try
it tastes
yet.
Like the anisette cookies.
Yeah, I got. Yeah,
that's what it tastes like.
Okay. Oh, an anisette cookie. Cool, because of the almond. That's why.
Unbelievable. Yeah. And these are low carb.
Yeah, those might
How many
be
carbs.
They might even be less. 3.
3 grams of carbs.
There's no sugars though.
How much protein is this?
14.
I would go as far to say that this is his best cookie.
Georgie, what are you sweetening that with?
Sucralose.
Oh, okay.
Perfect. It is, John, I'm telling you, it's the best cookie he's made.
I mean, there's
how many calories in it, Mr. G?
It even has the mouthfeel of an
160, 70.
Wow. I mean, there's nothing really to count.
I reserve the right to make that determination.
Send John a bunch of these.
I will.
I'm telling you, you're going to be so impressed with this cookie.
Good. I met someone that grows lettuce, hydroponically, and they grow all sorts of stuff out in Montana. and they could grow lettuce at five and all the greens at five times the rate that regular farmers can. And he's going to try and work on making a lettuce flour.
I told him, can you make lettuce flour, John?
It needs fiber. You could do it out of kale. It has to have more fiber.
You can. My mother used to make artichoke flour, which is like, you know what I mean, pasta.
Maybe kale. Yeah. Kale would be good. What about kale flour?
But you want to mix them. I'm constantly trying
kale
to.
Kale is a new superfood. Like everyone's talking about kale. Maybe that's the way to do it.
If it's sweet,
yeah, kale's amazing.
You want to mix them. So you're probably going to want to mix it with an almonds. And so this.
I'm telling you, better. I hate to say it. It's better than the white macadamia.
Lee's gonna.
I'll tell you what. His Reese's. They're not Reese's. His peanut butter cups are better than Reese's. They're the best peanut butter cups.
Unbelievable.
Ever.
Well, the funny story, cookies. He took
the
those
sugar
off.
The cookies are good, too.
He took those off the website, and someone asked him for it. He put it back on. Did you sell like a couple $1,000 for it?
Yes. All my customers, you know, we got loyal customers. Like,
people got mad that he took them off.
The sugar cookies are phenomenal. My girlfriend stole all the fucking sugar cookies that he sent me. She loved them.
Romano, remember we told him to take all the stuff off his website and just put the cookie up? He got like people calling him, like threatening him, like, why'd you take that off?
Well, I mean, the customers, of course, are going to,
Those peanut butter, that peanut butter is made with the Dave's isolized protein, but nobody would, bro, those peanut butter cups are sick.
Yeah, they
they're
are
fucking,
good.
They're dangerously fucking.
You're going to be able to buy them.
He said he grinds his own peanuts, right, Mr. G? You grind your own peanuts?
Yeah.
But Mr. G's proteinsnacks.com, right?
Yes.
Okay.
You're going to be able to buy that stuff on a daily basis at Busy Body, and we're going to have a location in Delray, set up like a bakery.
Yeah,
the bakery.
George, are you still making the peanut butter by itself in the jar, or is that just for us?
That was just for us.
No, we'll you know what? We'll wind up once this Busy Body gym, they're almost done with construction. Once they're done, then we'll start putting that stuff in there. You know.
Oh, by the way, update on Aaron Singerman. Him and I are now email buddies. I'm on his list. We've emailed back and forth a couple of times. He had a horrendous... I asked him what happened because I wanted to relay it on the show. When he got taken into custody, you know, when they revoked his bond or whatever, he was in, like, holding cells all over the place, and he was... They gave him diesel therapy, John, as you suspected, from holding to holding.
Yeah, yeah.
Until he finally
across
went to
the street, they got to go to Boston.
Yeah, went to West Palm Beach to get to Miami. He said he was everywhere. He was in every hold, and every time now with the jails is when you get moved from prison to prison, you got to go to quarantine because of COVID. Yeah. So he basically was in a cell with two people. He said he only showered three times a week. It was crazy. Finally, when they started shipping him from Miami, I guess up to try to get him up to Pensacola, where he was. By the way, that's where he was, I guess, put in. They stopped in Tallahassee on the way. Remember, we thought that he was actually put in Tallahassee because, according to the Federal Bureau, he was in Tallahassee for I think a week or something like that. Once again, they have to quarantine you there. He said when he finally got to Pensacola, he thought he was, I'm finally here. I'm going to be relaxed. I'm going to love this. And then they had to quarantine him another 2 weeks, of course. And then he finally was released. He said, "Now it's like completely, you know, changed now. Now he's he works out twice a day. You know, he's teaching."
So where is he? Where is he?
He's in Pensacola now.
Isn't that where he wanted to go?
Yes. He was always going there. He just there was the reason why. I guess every time you go to another prison, they log you in on the federal prison website. That's why it looked like he was there, but he was just there for like a week or two.
He was just moving around. Yeah,
he said,
I don't know how they treated you, but yeah. I got the federal pen tour. They sent me to Boron, right? That's between LA and Las Vegas in the middle of the desert, right? I had to go to fucking Milan, Michigan, wherever that fucking was.
Yeah.
I had to go to Pleasanton, Shut the fuck up, dude. You've never been to prison.
I live in Michigan. It's Jackson Prison.
I don't
prison.
Give a fuck. You weren't in prison. Shut the fuck up.
I know, but it's Jackson Prison in
I've
Michigan.
Had enough of you. Shut the fuck up. You talk when you're spoken to and not any other time. You're low man on the fucking totem pole. We've always had a fucking whipping post. We had Chewbacca. We had Billy Guns. We had Diego. Now we got you. Shut the fuck up.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good. Shut the fuck up. You talk when you're spoken to. You. So yeah, they travel you all over the place, and they stick you in one stupid fucking cell after another, chain of 10 guys, go across the street.
Anyway, so he's situated. I guess he's teaching like business classes at the jail, and he's. I guess everyone knows who he is from Redcon and all that stuff. So he's doing
that. He's going to be a superstar.
Yeah.
So he's teaching God, business. Yeah, yeah. But he's in jail.
Well, he was a successful business guy.
No, well, successful in sales. Just, yeah. I mean, obviously.
Just showing people how to become their own entrepreneurs.
Look, anybody who generates that amount of sales.
Well, look,
it's got to know. It's not easy.
Right. What he did with Blackstone was wrong. But when he went to Redcon, he did it by the book, you know. And so, which is a shame because he could have done it the right way from the beginning.
They're the first guys to go on Instagram and use it as a home shopping network, you know, and have all these they had thousands of people from around the country that were like their little ambassadors to their product.
Are there pistachio nuts in here?
Yeah, real.
This is good. That's
why is Romano mad at me today?
Did anybody ask you anything?
While we got Jimmy the Bull here, let Jimmy the Bull talk. We might lose him, John.
Jimmy came in here. He's smiling the whole fucking time. It seems
I'm glad you're in a good mood, John. I mean, Jimmy.
I'm waiting for you to yell at me, motherfucker.
Oh, you didn't do anything wrong.
John, you said you could trap Jimmy.
I gotta tell you the truth.
What the fuck? Are you deaf?
Okay.
Shut the fuck up. Nobody talked to you. Shut up.
I won't say nothing.
Don't say a fucking word until you're spoken to.
Okay.
You just did it again. Shut the fuck up.
So back to Johnny Bravo. You know, I used to come across guys like you all the time, John, back in the day.
They're all dead.
And I, you know, even when I was in junior high and high school, the one year I attended high school, so I quit after
one
that. But
year.
Anyway, before, you know, in junior high, I used to beat the shit out of motherfuckers like you in the band. And fucking leave them there on the floor. And I used to go to my class, made like nothing happened. I used to come across guys like you all the time. Uh-huh. Matter of fact, I have some friends here in New York that want to meet you.
Oh, yeah,
I showed them a picture of you, and they says, "Is he ever going to come up here?" I says, "Yeah, he'll come here one day, because he wants to come up here to, you know, he wants to hang with me and tangle."
I'm going
to
move over there, motherfucker.
And
so
they said, they'd love to meet you. You know,
no problem. They'd I got friends over there. Don't forget, I'm from there originally.
Yeah, I know. Where are you from? Syracuse?
No, where motherfucker. I grew up in Rockland County and Bergen County, New Jersey.
Listen, you know, it really doesn't sound good when you're cursing me with that fucking hairdo you got on there. It really doesn't.
You wish you had this fucking hairdo.
It doesn't really. It's not.
Let me see your fucking hairdo. Take off that fucking do-rag. Who wears a do-rag?
I mean, really, who do you? I don't want to turn this into a Johnny Bravo Rob show, but who the fuck do you think you are, bro?
Listen, you know what my father always told me growing up?
What do you think? Goes, who do you think you are?
If somebody fucking bullies you, you punch him right in the fucking mouth back. You bullied me from the first day.
Is that what you want
to
do to me, bro?
You
said you
motherfucking pussy takes 150 milligrams of testosterone. Huh? You made fun of my ass, so I got you back. And you know what? If you can't take it, don't dish it out.
Really? Well, you know, let me tell you something, bro. I've been around a long time, all right? And you don't scare me, and you don't mean nothing to me. So, I mean, I don't know, like, where you're coming off with all this tough guy talk, because you're really nothing to me. So, listen, if I was you, I'd shut your fucking mouth, go back to you making your fucking videos, whatever the fuck you do for a fucking living, I have no idea. With your fucking tank top on there. You look like something out of the Village People with that fucking tank top you got on over
there. I wore it for you, motherfucker, because...
Oh, you wore it for me?
He wanted to show his physique off you, Jimmy, I think.
Oh, you want to show his physique?
You want to fucking make fun of me, motherfucker.
Bro, you couldn't... Let me tell you something. You couldn't
see a double bicep pose, Johnny.
You couldn't fill a half of one of my shoes, bro.
Hey, motherfucker, you don't realize I'm 44. Okay. I'm going to be 44, motherfucker.
44, wow. Yeah. You're fucking, wow, 44. Wow, what does that mean?
I got
what does that mean, you're 44? What is that? What does that mean? I'm 44. What the fuck does that mean?
It means he looks up to you as a father figure,
that's
bro.
Right.
Well, he does. He's been calling me a motherfucker ever since I got on the show. He's been calling me a motherfucker.
You started the shit with me on the
you
first.
You started. I didn't say episode. A fucking word today, John, when I got on.
Not
here.
Today. Not
you're
today.
The one that called me a motherfucker right now, right? You
well,
started
you know what?
It with me.
You know what?
Right? I didn't say shit. I came on the show, peaceful, Jimmy, smiling, and then you said motherfucker.
Jimmy, listen,
and you started the whole thing right
listen,
there.
Listen,
I'm
laughing.
Tell you something. If I was standing in a room with you right now and you called me motherfucker, you wouldn't be fucking standing too long. I tell you
listen,
that right
Jimmy, remember the scene from Goodfellas, John Romano?
You might be fucking 44,
you
but
let
I'm
him talk to you like
motherfucker,
that?
And I've been around a fucking tree a long time more than you, motherfucker. And I'll fucking rip your fucking head off right now, you little fucking cocksucker. All right?
Jimmy, all we can see
is here's your 44 right here, motherfucker. Jimmy, shut your fucking mouth, because I ain't talking to you anyway, motherfucker.
You know what's the one
you thing? You gotta let him talk to you like that.
I don't
right,
want to fucking hear your voice, Johnny.
Listen,
I don't want to hear you.
Listen,
I don't want to
hear
your fucking voice, you
listen,
twat.
Asshole, you got
you're
mad at me for calling
twat.
You asshole. Let me explain
Jimmy,
something
what's the world I'm coming
let
to?
Let me explain something
fucking
to you
fucking guy get me all started. I come out, Dave. I came out here all peaceful.
Jimmy, what's it coming to? Come on.
Fuck you, boy. Fuck you,
listen,
Johnny
asshole.
Fucking
listen,
Bravo!
Asshole.
Where'd you get your name out of a bubblegum wrapper, you fucking cocksucker? Huh?
Let me.
We only see your chest, Jimmy. We don't see your face.
See your little fucking cocksucker.
Shut
your fucking mouth, Rob, you little bitch.
Shut up, your
you're a pussy, John.
Rob, don't even get involved. Nobody's
fucking. What is he doing talking? No one said your fucking name. Shut the fuck up.
Unbelievable.
Wait, you know what? This motherfucking Rob, all week, dude, he counts my subscribers. My fucking views.
Right, hold on. Let John and Romano and I get
and
some semblance
like,
of peace here.
Right,
stop. First of all, let me just say something. Johnny Bravo, you out of line. You attacked Jimmy right off the boat. You didn't even know what Jimmy was going to say to you yet. Jimmy might have tried to be making the peace with you
I
today.
I wasn't going to say anything to him. I was going to tell him about my day.
I know. And he attacked you. I agree. Very disrespectful. You assume.
He's a fucking
no, this is what happened. No, this is what happened. Big Rob built up in Johnny Bravo's head that Jimmy was going to attack him and destroy him on the show today.
I didn't say shit.
And so what you did was you anticipated that. And you didn't even let Jimmy say a word. So that's
correct.
You're out of line. So
I apologize.
You owe Jimmy an apology right off the bat.
I do. 100% I apologize. Listen, this is the thing that Jimmy doesn't understand. Is I've been watching this show, and I'm not kissing up right now like Rob, that little bitch, okay? I've been watching this show since the fucking beginning.
Nice
and I watched
guy.
All the episodes of Jimmy when you guys were in the fucking studio, and I always respected him. So I'm just fucking with you. You call me an asshole, I call you an asshole back. That's how it is. You're from New York. You know how it goes, dude. You can't get offended by this bullshit.
All right. Well, I'm glad that you apologized to Jimmy. He probably doesn't accept your apology, but it's okay. Now, Jimmy, you want to tell us what's going on with your day?
Listen, I got to tell you, man. I'm not really an argumentative person. I never really was. I mean, if I was out in a bar when I was younger, and I'm not talking about Mr. Bravo here. I'm talking about just in general. And I had some guy start mouthing. I would just fucking hit them. I'm not going to sit there and argue with somebody like two old fucking bag ladies back and forth. You know, I would just say, fuck this. And I would just, bam. And that'd be the fucking end of it. The guy'd be laying on the fucking floor.
And then you take him out for breakfast the next morning.
I'd step on his fucking head a few times. And I'm not an argumentative person. I don't like arguing. I got thrown off the job yesterday because I started arguing with the guy in the scale house because he was a fucking prick. All right, that's what happened. I pull up to the scale house, which is you pull the truck up on the scale. There's nobody in the yard. I fucking pull up there.
Well, hold on, let me ask you a question. Why do they weigh these trucks? What's the purpose of weighing the trucks?
You got to weigh empty first. You got to pull in the yard. You got to weigh empty, and then when you get your load, you swing back around. You get on the scale. Then they weigh you loaded, and that's how they charge you.
They also have to do that so the state
can't overload. Can't overload it, right?
Yeah, exactly. You can't overload it.
Yeah. So if you don't weigh the truck, you're not gonna know what the load is. So make a long story short. You know, I pull in the fucking yard, peaceful, a good mood. I had a half a smile on for some reason. And I fucking pull onto the fucking scale, you know, and I went nice and slow because you can't pull on the scale fast because if you pull on the scale fast, the scale moves, you know, and the truck can fuck the scale up and, you know, fucks up the whole the system. So anyway, I pull onto the fucking scale nice and slow and I get out and go to the window and the guy, there's a crabby motherfucker back there like Johnny Bravo, right? And I said, I said to the guy, I said, how you doing, sir? I'm here to pick up a load of stone, you know, 3/4 inch blue. He goes, let me ask you a question. I said, this is how the guy started. I was being very nice. And he says to me, did you see that little stop sign there? And I go, I said, the little stop sign there before the scale? He says, yeah. I says, yeah, I did see that little stop sign. He goes, well, you got to stop at that stop sign. You didn't stop. I says, excuse me, sir. I said, I rolled on very, very slow. There's nobody in the yard. The place is deserted. I says, I was very respectful. I came on the scale nice and slow. Yeah. He goes, well, next time you got to stop on that stop sign. I says, he goes, and what's the pleasure of having you here today? I said, well, I got to pick up some blue so you don't let me finish over here. He says, wow, you don't have an account here. I never seen you before. I said, well, I never really been here before either. I said, you know, but I says, I got to call my boss to get the fucking credit card. No problem. You know, take it easy. You know what I mean? He goes, all right, well, make your phone call. So I make the phone call. I had it on loudspeaker and I hand it to the guy. He goes, I don't want to touch your phone. I don't want to touch your phone. I said, okay. I said, no problem. I put it on loudspeaker. I said, yo, bro. He said, I need a credit card, right? So, of course, they didn't have one. So I had to pull off the scale and I had to go wait fucking 10 minutes to have a credit card. Then the guy comes out of the scale. He's waving at me like, you know, all frantic. And he's like, pull back around on the scale. I got the credit card. I go get loaded. I come back. The credit card's declined.
Oh, no.
So now the guy's really irate with me. He's telling me, pull off. Get in the front over there. Goes, and make sure you're out of the way. The rest of the truck's coming in and out of here. Get over there. So I'm like, take it easy, bro. I said, you know, all of a sudden, I lost it.
Yeah.
I said, you know something? You're a fucking prick. I said, you know what? I said, I was in a good mood till I came to this fucking
duck
yard.
Down.
You little fucking cocksucker. I said, you just got me in a fucking irate move. You're going to fuck yourself. Right? All of a sudden, he makes the phone call. My boss calls. I got thrown off the job. I can't go back.
What?
And I was being nice.
Right. Why is he yelling at you? You're not the owner.
That's what I was trying to tell the guy. I said, listen, I'm the fucking, like, the messenger. Don't shoot me. I came here. I'm getting a load of fucking stone. That's all I want. That's all I know, bro. Unbelievable. Yeah, being nice. You can't be nice to anybody.
So, Jimmy, you actually had to leave the yard without the stone?
No, I had to wait till my boss came down with another credit card. I had to go through a whole fucking thing. I was there fucking like an hour and a half with the stone, man. And it wasn't even my fault. I was the mother innocent motherfucker.
So how did you get thrown off the job? Who drove the truck?
Well, I got thrown off. I wasn't allowed back there to get another load.
Oh.
Because the guy didn't want to deal with me the fucking half the bag.
Oh, my God.
So anyway.
What about his boss? His boss.
I hate guys that are on power trips like that.
Bro, he was like, I don't know what the fuck his problem was. He was, I said, I was looking at him like something was wrong with him. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, what's this guy? I'm going to get off the wrong side of the fucking bed today or something. I don't understand it, man. Anyway, so then I get up this morning at 4 o'clock. This is the kind of fucking week I'm having. I get up, I fucking get my lunch, I take a shit, my coffee, I fucking shoot all the way out to Amagansett. You know where that is, right?
Yeah, all the way out. Yeah.
Yeah, way out. The traffic. I had to go through the Shinnecock Nation. It took me 3 fucking hours to get out there at Amagansett, right? I pull up to the job site. All the guys are over there digging and with the machines and everything. I pull up and they're all looking at me like I just got out of a fucking spacecraft or something. Yeah. You know, so I roll my window and I go, what's up, fellas? They go, what are you doing here? I says, what do you mean what I'm doing here? I says, the foreman told me to come here this morning. What do you mean what am I doing? Well, we didn't know you were coming. I says, well, then someone needs to get on the phone with the foreman, man. I said, you know, I just drove 3.5 fucking hours to get out of here with the traffic. And, you know, they make a phone call. All of a sudden they tell me, yeah, they said, we don't need the truck today. I'm like,
you
don't need the truck today? I says, I'm at 3.5 hours to get out of here. The fuck? I says, I'm sorry, Jimmy. Don't get mad at me. He goes, that's what I was just told. You know what I mean? So I called the foreman. And I says, yo, Jim. I says, no truck today? He goes, I'm sorry. It's not your fault. There's a lot of shit going on here. I got more fucked up. I'm sorry. I needed you now. I don't need you. I says, no problem, bro. I says, no problem. I left. I called my boss on the way back. He says, what happened? I told him what happened. I get all the way fucking home. Calls me up again. He says, what happened? I said, what do you mean? I told you 3 hours ago what the fuck happened. Is everybody losing their fucking mind or something? I told you 3 hours ago what the fuck happened. The guy told me he don't need the truck. I had him drive back. I'm in the yard now. He goes, oh, okay, I just gotta be square with you because I gotta tell them that what happened. I said, well, that's what happened. Call up the foreman.
Do you get paid for that?
Yeah, fuck yeah. I told my boss, I said, I'm getting my 8 hours. I don't give a fuck. Right. I said, this ain't my fault driving fucking 6-7 hours back and forth traffic, going through the Shinnecock Nation. Fucking unbelievable. I just forget it.
Hold on, when you go through the Shinnecock Nation, which is the Indian reservation, what is it? Like, is there a dirt road? What do you have to go through? I don't even know.
No, so
He has to push the truck. He's not allowed to use the motor.
No, so the Shinnecock Nation is that's their land, that's their reservation. So
right.
You know, you're going down Sunrise Highway. You know, so you basically, I take the Long Island Expressway, which is a shithole now.
Right.
You know, I get off 70, and I go south till I hit Sunrise, and then you start going east.
Right.
And then all of a sudden you come into these like two big giant neon fucking signs, you know, with all this shit flashing, and it's the Shinnecock Nation, and you go through there, and they that's where they live, man. That's everything over there. They own, they have. You see, like businesses, you know, all in. They all own the businesses and the houses and all the cigarettes. Everybody goes out there for cigarettes and stuff, because you get First Nation cigarettes. They're cheap. There's no tax on them, I guess, or whatever.
They got their own cops and shit. Their own.
Oh, really?
Everything. Yeah. Well, no, they got state troopers out there, because only the state is allowed on that property. You can't get regular.
Now you have to go. Is the speed limit lower? Or what, I mean, what's the problem with going through there?
Well, there's really no problem. The speed limit is kind of regular, but once you get into like the area, it's like a 30 mile an hour speed zone. Okay. So you got to go slow too and all that, because they get very upset.
Now you know why these jobs cost so much money, John, because the fuck ups are left and right all day long. That's guaranteed. Right. They're wasting
all
so much money.
All day long. It's unbelievable, man. Unbelievable. The state actually got mad at my boss because they break in the balls. You know, the state breaks his balls. He breaks the state balls. Well, you know, you can't fight with the state. So now all of a sudden they're telling us that we need a new survey for the next spot. Normally we just use the same survey for each storm drain. But now they want a new survey for every fucking storm drain. So now they held up the job for weeks. I mean, it's a fucking nightmare, bro.
What are they building storm drains for?
On the parkway, North State Parkway. They have, the areas that they're redoing the storm drains were built probably in the 40s and the 50s. You know what I mean? So they're redoing all the storm drains. So it's a lot of work for us, but we're always getting our balls broken. You know what I mean?
Well, I'm glad you're good.
They should do like they do in Mexico, Jimmy. They just leave the storm drains out.
Yeah, they just have giant floods and all that shit.
They do. The water comes up like 2 feet high in the rain.
All right.
Yeah, I know. You can't do that here, John. You know how it is.
Hey, Greg, did you hear about the guy who got vaccinated 90 times?
No.
Yeah, there's a guy out there who got vaccinated 90 times. And because he was selling the vaccination cards. I think he was in Australia, this guy. I don't know if Tyler could pull the story up anywhere. 90 times in the same location. It took them 90 times before they figured out that this guy had come here 90 times.
What happened?
Are you serious?
Did he get sick? He had to have gotten sick.
He obviously didn't. He had it 90 times. He got vaccinated. He was selling the vaccination card. So every time
that's got to kill some of the guys watching this shit. Because when I got vaccinated, because I had to, my sister, I had people tell me, "You're gonna die 6 months. Oh, you're fucking not real. Oh, you're going against your own creed. You're against the vaccine." I'm not against the vaccine. I'm pro-choice. If you want the vaccine, you get the vaccine. If you don't, you don't.
Oh, Jeremy?
I'm not for forced vaccines.
Hold up the story.
I don't like the vaccine. But
wait, Dave, did you say the guy got shot up 90 times?
90 times because he wanted to take the vaccine cards and sell them, which he probably made a lot of money doing.
Well, you know what he probably did was he probably just right when the nurse was coming at him with the pin, he pulled out $100 bill.
I don't think so.
Squirt that in the trash.
Or to do what Joe Biden does. It's an empty fucking syringe.
There it is. Man in Germany gets 90 COVID-19 shots to sell forged vaccination cards.
You know what, though? The government actually likes that because it boosts their vaccine numbers. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, shit.
I think probably after a while it doesn't do anything to you, right? I mean, you would think it's probably just like, you know, it's like pouring sand on the beach. 60
years old. Now, you know,
the guy's 60 too. Yeah, that's even funnier. Yeah,
we should get him on the show.
We have him on. His name is Rob. Big Rob.
Is he still alive?
Big Rob. Okay.
Big Rob, how many vaccines have you had?
I've had two, and then the booster.
So and you've I had really three plus the 87 other ones that you sold, right?
87 others that
you sold the vaccine card for, yeah.
Yes, yes.
Wait, you got really sick from the vaccine, or did you get sick because I'm going to be honest with you, I think most people get sick because they're not, you know when you first take steroids, right?
Yeah.
You first take your first shot, you get the steroid fever, you get that flu and shit. A lot of people that I know that got the shot was mostly because it's the shot. You know what I mean? And they're not used to get, like, I did get a tetanus shot, and so I'm like, wow, dude, nothing. You know what I mean? But the average person gets fucked up from that shit.
Well, that's Greg. That's why I think if you get after probably the third or fourth shot that this guy got, he probably wasn't having any reaction to it anymore.
Well, yeah, I'm a pincushion. You know what I mean? I wasn't a day, so it didn't bother me. Getting a shot was like nothing.
Greg, and
I
didn't get. Are you getting ideas now? Maybe I should go get some shots and sell the vaccine cards.
I can use the money.
I know you can. I know you can.
I can use the money.
That's easy money too.
I'm ready to sell my
ass. You never got the testosterone cough when you took the shot?
Oh, yeah. Dude, the trend. Yeah. That's like the 911 drug. You take it, fucking 2 minutes later, you call 911, I can't breathe. And then fucking 5 minutes later, you call him back, say, forget it, I'm good now. You know what I mean? Yeah, dude.
Isn't that really dangerous and powerful?
Jimmy, I got to tell you, me and my friend took Trent out of the same bottle. He would take like 2 cc's out of it, shoot it. I would take a fucking half a cc. I'm like a pussy. I'm on the ground like I got a meatball stuck in my throat. Like I
when we used to take the test shot, if we coughed after we took the shot, we always said, that's good stuff, man.
Yeah.
Dave, how come that doesn't happen consistently? Because sometimes I do a shot of Tren, I can't fucking breathe. I'm coughing all over the place, and then six consecutive shots, nothing happens. And
I think it's the alcohol content, John. I think there's alcohol.
I agree with that. I think it's
why does it happen not every time then?
Some have probably a little more alcohol than others.
I think the trend causes a constriction in the blood vessels and the lungs, and that's why it's hard to exchange oxygen. But what happens is I think what dictates whether you get that cough really bad or not is how fast the trend enters your bloodstream. So if you make a shot and it's sitting in the muscle a little longer and it trickles in, you're not going to get the cough. Whereas sometimes you ever take a shot, like sometimes I would take it in my lat and it was like instant. It was like the second it went in, I felt it in my, I could smell it in my nose.
Yeah, you could taste it too.
Yeah, you know, and that's like when you get the cough usually, you know.
Hey, John, you're still doing trend? John.
Injectable D-ball with Reformat B with that fucking B
vitamins. Yeah, the vitamins.
Remember that shit?
Yep.
Reformat B, injectable D-ball. I would take that shit and I'd be like, oh my God. And you're burping like, burp, like this. And you're like, oh, like you had fucking, like you ate a bottle of vitamins. But how do you explain that my friend, maybe because I used a fucking 20 gauge fucking needle and he was using like an insulin, but he took 2 cc's of out of the same bottle.
Because yours hit your bloodstream faster. That's why.
Dude, I use a fucking 20 gauge. I can't.
Rick, that's what I used to do with Sustanon back in the day. And I didn't know any better. I used to just take it out of the little plastic coffin, shove it right in the ass, right? And I was like, holy shit. And that thing was like
nails,
a fucking,
baster. Like, right? You basted fucking.
Yeah, I was like, you know, and then a friend of mine one day, he was like, I told him what happened. He goes, you asshole. He goes, you got to take the plunger out of the back and draw it out with a regular, idea.
Then they switched. You know? They switched, probably even now. I love that they switched. They don't have the needles on them anymore. And it's just like a, it has like
an amulet.
It has a little like rubber stopper that you can kind of put a syringe tip on it. The problem is never do that because it doesn't twist on. It just pushes on. So when you take the shot, the thing explodes and it goes everywhere.
Well, you got to
remember that. You know what I'm talking about, Greg, right?
On the glass.
It goes everywhere, I mean, with that stuff.
It did come in an ambulance later on. Like you crack the little.
What happens is they put it in the same glass syringe, but there was no tip on it. So it was like a little rubber stopper. And
wait, Dave, I got to tell you a quick story. I was in New York City. I was with, you remember the Polish guy that used to own the, I was in Worlds of Power. Anyway, I don't want to say his name on here. It'll fucking kill me. But we were in a restaurant and the cops were fucking watching us and shit. We got outside. I had ampules, fucking big fucking boxes with ampules of fucking Sustanon and Winstrol V, right? And the cops are opening it up. And they're looking at, like, they stopped me, right? They're looking at a car. They're opening it up, and they're looking at the ampules like this. And one cop goes, I think it's perfume. That's what I told him. Yeah, it's perfume. So then he let me go.
Wow.
Dude, he fucking thought they were perfume samples because they didn't think, like, it would come in a glass ampule. You know what I mean? Like, they just pulled me over because I looked suspicious.
Did you have the little file with it, Greg? You had a little file on the deck, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. They're probably users themselves and just wanted to let you go.
No, I got pulled over.
They had no idea. They had no
the
idea.
Worst, the worst thing, those ampules, when they bust in your hand and the glass explodes.
Oh.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, you got to put a towel over that. If you don't crack it with a towel, you're crazy.
Did. I put a towel and I bite the tip like this, and it never cracked. I would get that shit
I used to score it with my teeth. You know, like you score the ampule?
What's funny is though, some are worse than others. Some open up easy and some don't open up as easy.
I gotta jump on John's story there. I used to, the ampule, the top used to break.
Right.
So sometimes when you go to snap the neck, it would crush. And if all the glass would go inside, I'd still draw it out.
No, you didn't. No, I threw it out. I was pissed.
Never.
No, you don't throw it out.
The glass can't get in there.
Greg would suck it off the floor probably. If
I stuck the dart right in there. Glass
little glass don't hurt nobody, right?
Hold on. Admit, I want you to admit this. I know all of you guys have used Winchell V. How many of you guys have dropped the bottle on the ground, cracked it, and then tried to suck up as much as you could off the floor before you thought it was no good anymore?
Dude, I did that. I was a drug dealer. I've done that. I had so many fucking ampules. Dude, I'd have like boxes of Steris. You remember that they used to case like this, right? I'd have boxes. I'd be maybe hundreds, over 1,000 ampules. I dropped vials. I dropped a vial, and I was a cheap motherfucker. I'd be sucking it off the floor like that.
I never did Winnie.
It's like when I got arrested. I had cases of needles. Meanwhile, I was reusing the needle. It was like a fish hook coming in me like that. You know what I mean? I'm getting infections and shit, you know?
Have you ever seen like what a needle, after you use it once, looks like under a microscope?
It's curled up.
It's curled. It's like the tip, the metal tip, looks like someone just curled it over with like a pair of pliers.
I think I know what picture you're talking about. Yeah. It was after it went in the plunger.
Oh, just through the plunger? Oh, my God.
Just the plunger. Then that's what started that whole thing with, you know, you draw with a big needle and then you screwed a little one on. But
yeah. Because what happens
is that why it makes that ripping noise through your ass?
Yes. You're ripping tissue, right.
preload I used in Mexico, the needle was so fucking big. I think it was an 18 gauge. I stuck the 23 gauge through the fucking pin to suck the shit out of it.
Dude, I shot myself with an 18 gauge. I swear to God, I did.
You love these. You got needle arcana.
Dude, I love it. You know what the worst part is? When you get a hard spot where you shoot and you can't get the oil out, and you're like, this fucking, you know what I mean? You pull it out, you move it a couple times like that, and then it fucking. I used to push against the wall.
Suspension was like that, Greg.
But yeah, I love.
Greg? Did you used to cycle out and off?
Man, I never cycled. I just did the whole. I just kept going.
He only did it for 3 years though, before he was arrested.
Cycle is, Rob? I tell you what a cycle is. You're doing 1,200 milligrams a week, and you go down to like 3, and then you go back up.
Jimmy, I was taking 6,000.
That's the cycle.
I was taking 6,000.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I was taking a vial, 200 milligram, 10 cc, you know, either tespropionate or cypionate. I would take it 3 times a week, one on Monday, one on Wednesday, and one on Friday. That's 2,000 milligrams.
Now, Greg, did you shoot this? What, did you move it around, or did you do like bicep one day, the next bicep the next day? Or
I moved it around, but I mean, like, yeah, right. Like you,
did you do a little here, a little there, a little there every time?
It would depend, you know what I mean? I don't think
he did it in his neck, John.
I always had the fucking syringe full. So if I do three there, I'd be like, well, I got to do three there now. So I do the three now. Now I look at the bottle and there's still some left. And I'm like, fuck. You know what I mean? But this, now I just use 6 cc's, right? So 3 and 3, that's 6. Now there's like 4 cc's left. I got to take out 2 and maybe crack the sustenance so make it 3 like that to take out the side. That's how I do a whole bottle. So I would do a whole bottle of test, then maybe 2 ampules of fucking sustenance.
You know what I found out? The suspension, you always used to get jammed up. You know, I used to love that shit, but you know, you put it in, and then halfway through it stop, and then you got to pull it out and then redo it. And before you know it, you got 4 or 5 fucking holes going.
That's right.
So I had a friend of mine, you know, told me take a little B12, and just after you load it up, you stick it in the B12, and you pull back a little B12, man, and the shit goes right in, man, every time.
You know why? Because the suspension had crystals in it, and I think that would jam up the needle.
Yeah, it was chalky.
I never used a fucking insulin needle. I was like, fuck that. If you're using, because a lot of guys, well, it's water-based. So
I used to use the vitamin needle, the insulin needle.
Yeah,
right?
It's like an insulin. Yeah, I never used that. I would use the fucking, and I could never do just, it would just kill me to see empty space in that goddamn, in the barrel of the fucking You know, I'd have to fill it with three CCs. And I was doing that way before Boston Lloyd was fucking, you know, when he was a little boy. Because
you were really, you were the original three CC guy.
Oh, dude. Hell yeah.
I thought you used the fives, the big one, the five CC.
No. I only use three. I would use the three CC.
The problem with a five CC or a 10 CC syringe was that the barrel is too big and it's pushing, you know, the oil into a little opening. Whereas the three CC was almost the barrel size was almost the same as the opening, so the oil went through much easier. Whenever you went. Because I tried to do a 5cc syringe once, and it just took forever. And if you pushed hard enough on that syringe, what would happen?
The needle would pop off.
It
would
shoot, and it would go everywhere.
Dude, have you ever had the needle?
Try to clean that oil off like a mirror in your kitchen sink or your bathroom sink. It goes everywhere.
Who the fuck uses a 5cc? That's like something they use in the institution. 5, 10 cc.
They make bigger. Speaking of the oil going all over the place and having to clean it. The first time I was one of the first times I was making juice in Mexico. After you dissolve the powder in the oil, you got to filter it, right? And you got to filter it through a two micron filter, which is very, very fine. So some guys stick them on the end of the syringe, but I'm making 2,000 bottles at a time. I can't do that. So I had to come up with a method to do it. So I got a peristaltic pump, and I had the pump pushing the stuff through the tube, and then the tube through the I got the big cartridge filter, and I'm doing it that way. But the cartridge filter is for water base. So I'm heating up the oil to make it a little more viscous. So I got the oil at about 130 degrees.
Oh my God, that sounds dangerous.
And my peristaltic pump had two modes, A and B. One is fast and one is slow. And I forgot from the last setting, I didn't take a picture of the panel, whatever I didn't fucking do. And I got it on the wrong one. I turned the thing on. The pump is going
this. Oh, no.
2 seconds later, the fucking tube in the filter pops off. Oh. Just oil is everywhere. I still have a sweatshirt with a big stripe of oil across the front of it. That was a disaster. Not to mention the fact that probably 30 bottles got.
And it was 130 degrees, the oil.
And it was 130 degrees.
Dude, did you ever get the needle break off, though? I've actually had to pull it out with pliers. You ever get that? With a SNIDER. Yeah. Maybe because like I reused the needle fucking 55.
I'm surprised, Greg, that you didn't just push it in deeper and just leave it in there.
Wait, you know what? Wait, I have a funny story for you. One time. Wait, let me tell you this. You guys know those needles that, like, that when you inject it, like, they go inside the needle itself? You know what I'm talking about?
No.
The needle itself, when you inject it, they're meant to go back into the syringe.
Oh, those safety ones.
Okay, I didn't know those existed, right?
Yeah, that was for the HIV when that was out, yeah.
I went and took a fucking injection, right? I looked at the needle. I didn't see the needle there. I was scared as fuck. I went to the fucking hospital. I said, listen, I fucking was doing an injection. The needle stuck in my ass. They're like... And then they did a fucking x-ray. They couldn't find nothing, right? And then I went back home and I looked at the fucking package.
Oh, no.
And it's those fucking needles. I didn't even know those existed.
Yeah, yeah. Those were came out when HIV was big because people get needle sticks from it.
Well, no, because they didn't want them to reuse the needles. So
no, it was the needle sticks. They didn't want people capping the needles. Because when you cap the needles,
I don't care what anybody
says.
I used to love the fucking adage roll, the brown bottle with the fucking white cap. The Syntex. You remember those?
Of course.
Those were the best.
All right, I got a question for all of us.
I love it.
I'm going to go around the horn. Right. Start with Dave. Name a drug that was big back in the day that you can't get anymore that you wish you could.
Let me say
Dianabol was great. That was
Belastarone. Belastarone
was a good one. That's another one you got to take with a huge pin.
Methandrol dipropionate.
You talking about injectable, John?
Remember methandrol dipropionate? It supposedly resensitized the androgen receptors.
That's right. That's well, man. That goes way back.
Yeah. What about PGF2, the prostaglandin?
No, that was terrible, Greg. That was terrible shit.
I used to get that. Never took it. It was never terrible. Took it, but I had friends that would take.
How about real Essiclean, formabolin?
Oh yeah, I would. You know who used to love using that was Duchesne. on his clients. You know how many injections you have to give?
Oh
with
my
that?
God! It and it hurts too. It leaves
like,
you sore.
It's like a bee sting, and you got to do it like 1,000 times all over the place. It's all, the locatable area is only about like that.
They still make Primobolan, John. Is that still around?
Yeah, Primobolan.
Yeah, it's European.
It's a lot of fake.
Steering was the one who made the best one.
Is anything real?
Germany, yeah.
Is there any real stuff?
Hey, did you ever take prostaglandin? Did you ever take PGF too?
I couldn't get through one bottle, Greg. It was so horrible.
Somebody told me that you know, one of the guys that
I call it flu in a bottle. You take a shot, you get the flu.
No, yeah, but you fucking, it's an abortion medicine for cattle. So that shit would give guys cramps. They would feel like they're giving birth, right?
Yeah. I don't think it was an abortion medicine.
When you take that high of a dose?
What's that?
What would it do to you mentally when you would take those high doses?
I loved it. I got to be honest with you. I fucking loved it. Just
Rob, did you take it?
Ask the people at the Sound Factory, Rob, Big Rob, and they'll tell you what they did to Greg.
Yeah, I loved it, bro. I loved every minute of it. I would do it now if I wasn't 60 fucking going to be 62 years old. You know what I mean? I love it. When Jimmy was talking about the suspension, I was sitting back going, holy shit, I think I'm getting hard. You know what I mean? I loved all that. I'm not going to lie.
Well, it makes you stronger.
I'm afraid now because of
suspension. I tell you, Greg, suspension was fucking good stuff.
Oh, I loved it.
I don't care what anybody says.
Jimmy, I had a friend that I saw him on Monday. I saw him on Thursday again. And I was like, what the fuck did you do from Monday to Thursday?
Yeah, suspension.
Every day he was banging that suspension.
Yeah, that stuff was great.
Bro, I loved all of that shit.
I was so aggressive, you know, between the test, the Adderall and suspension, man. I was out of my fucking skull.
Not only that, but you're ready to fucking, I would fuck a dirt mound. You know what I mean? If I saw a fucking a hole in my grass, I'd fucking be on top of your fucking, I mean, I was crazy.
That's the only problem is you're extremely fucking horny, man. Yeah. That's
all
nuts.
The time. Yeah. All the time.
I had like that's probably what ruined my life. That's all I had on my mind. It's women, you know. It's like, well, I should have put all that energy into something that would have benefited me later in my life. You know.
I told Jimmy what you should have been.
What?
I said Jimmy should have been a musician. He missed his calling. He had natural music ability. He could play the piano without any lessons. He could play guitar without any lessons. Can you imagine if he was actually put all the energy put into his lifting into his music? He would be like a rock star on TV, you know?
Yeah. And then the Who could have said, we got busted up all the equipment from him.
It would have been like Slash, you know what I mean? Or something like that, you know?
Yeah.
I know. Look at me now.
Except that he was so big and stiff, he couldn't hold the guitar, though.
But if he would have just done the music, not the bodybuilding.
He didn't do that, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you know what, though? The only thing is, though, at my age, people ask me, why don't you want to be? It's like I see Dave. Dave posts a picture of himself. I tell people, Dave Palumbo was the original Mass Monster. You don't fucking know. You can look at a picture, but if you saw him in person, I mean, even pictures, he's a monster. But to see him in person at 325 pounds, he was just, and no body fat was fucking crazy. But nobody realizes that at our age, I'm going to be 62 years old. Yeah. Me and Jimmy and John are the same age. But let me tell you, I'm afraid. I don't want to fucking get a heart attack and die. So, you know, I don't do that shit no more. But smart. I would love
to. You're not doing any tests, Greg, or anything like that?
I do the doctor.
Yeah, a maintenance, right?
But
the
thing is, I haven't done a couple, you know, like 2 months because I just had surgery on this hand. Now I have, look, there's the stitches. I got to get them out.
Oh.
That's a very small incision, Greg.
Yeah, it's
What the hell is that from?
I had surgery not last Friday, Friday before. So I got to go after the show. I got to go to the doctor to get the stitches taken out.
Yeah, but what happened?
It was some chronic jerking off, Jimmy.
Four any chance. And then like, you know, like kind of, I started out like.
I knew somebody was going to say that.
Yeah.
No, this is my left hand when I had it on the right hand. But
carpal tunnel or something?
No, Dupinson's, you know, like I got that way. Like, you know, John Elway, where if my hands were like this. You know?
Really?
Yeah.
What, they freeze up?
Yeah. I can't make a fist. I couldn't fight it. What's, like this.
Greg, what's the cancer? Did you get scanned for the cancer again? I
got
to go.
Yes, so far, knock on wood, the cancer hasn't come back. Good. Yes, but I got the cancer. I mean, they cut me here. They cut me down the throat. Three surgeries.
Have they done a scan on you at all, or what did they do to check up?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, I just had one about a month ago.
Yeah, I got to go for my yearly They're going to do a whole body scan on me to see if the...
But my throat's not normal, though. Ever since they cut it, you're punching bags in the middle. Mine's all the way to the right now. Oh. But they cut, there's scar tissues in there. Remember, I was cut 3 times in 5 weeks.
No, I know.
I almost died the last one, so that's why.
Yeah, so, Brett,
what made you realize
you got off the ventilator?
What made you realize you had the Frankenstein?
It is, Jim. I couldn't make a fist. When I work out, it would loosen up a little bit, But I'd have pain even at night. When I wake up in the morning, you're like this,
Really? I never even heard it.
Greg, let me ask you a question. Did you
John Elway has that stuff.
Every once in a while, my hand goes like this.
You locks up a little bit. You got a trigger finger.
Yeah, that's like my hand lock up sometimes.
Yeah, I've had that surgery too. I've had 4 surgeries.
Wait, so your hand would just lock up like this every once in a while?
Lock up, yeah.
And then
I got that ulna. You know, the ulna surgery? I had that done. And my hand, once in a while, my left hand will, if I'm playing guitar, I have to actually pull it off the neck. And then I gotta smash it on the ground.
That happened to me the first time I took growth. First time I took growth, I woke up, my hands were like this.
I never took growth. I never did that.
That would make me not want to take it anymore, John. You get up in the morning looking like that.
Oh, man. Yeah, I told Jimmy Quinn. He goes, I just put duct tape around my wrist. Jimmy Quinn sleeping with duct tape like this.
I remember Jimmy Quinn used to hang out with Troy Moore.
Yeah.
And it was like mini me. Because it was like Quinn was like the biggest bodybuilder you could ever see in life, and Troy was like 5 foot tall, and the two of them would hang out together.
Troy said he lived it, right?
When we used to bounce in the bar, Quinn used to wear shorts, right? His calves were fucking tremendous, right?
So the
girls used to come in the bar and they used to look at his legs, and Quinn used to go, I had a car accident. He said, that's my old deformed shit, right? And they actually believed him because it looked so fucking,
Plus Quinn used to wear Dave's uniform all the time. Your shorts and the spaghetti tee tied up.
He would tie it though and show
me. He got me fucking doing that.
Yeah, like he would tie it like a chick.
I gotta say, when we trained in Rouse, we trained with Freeman McNeil, Gastineau was there, Cooney, Jerry Cooney. Yeah,
Where was that?
Rab's Health Club in Huntington. It was in a basement. Chris Confessori, Neil and Chris trained there.
Wow.
We had some fucking crew there. Matter of fact, we used to train hard. And being that it was in a basement, it was under Sam Ash. It used to rain because the condensation with the pipes running under it. So we used to have rainstorms in the fucking.
Oh, really?
So one time Richie wanted us to paint the locker room. So we all fucking moved the lockers, these big, huge ass lockers. I think I told you this before. And we moved the lockers away from the wall, we looked back, there was like fucking 10,000 syringes laying behind the locker. Everybody used to shoot and just throw behind the locker,
Wait, crazy, Jimmy, that crazy. Jimmy. That was Barrett's place?
Yeah, that was Richie Barrett's
so
place,
tell,
man.
Tell people who Rich Barrett
is. It was half a dojo and half the gym. It was a fucking amazing gym, man.
Jimmy, explain to people. Explain to people who Rich Barrett is, who he was.
He was the founder of American Combat Karate. He was on, matter of fact, you could Google him. He was on a Johnny Carson show. His famous thing was he used to wear the American the American flag gi, right? Yeah, he had long hair. Right. And Richie had one. He had one glass eye. I don't know if you know that, because when we were hanging out in California, we'd be at the bar and hanging out with a couple of chicks, and Richie had to go to the bathroom, so he would take his fucking eye out and put it on my shoulder. I'd say, keep an eye on these girls. And the girls used to go like, "Oh my god!" He had a fucking glass eye, right? So, but
very sterile technique, obviously, he was using. Yeah.
Yeah, he used to take. I swear to God, we used to be just standing there. All of a sudden, he'd take his eye, I put it on my shoulder, say, "I'll be right back. Keep an eye on these chicks." Right? I'm like, "Oh my god!" So anyway, so his famous thing was he used to take. I don't know how many. It was like slabs of granite, 1-inch slabs of granite, maybe like 30 of them. He used to space them. and then light them on fire, and then he would break them with the hammer fist, man. Go right through. He had a world record for that. Matter of fact, he went on and Johnny Carson's show. You could Google it. It's on YouTube. He broke the granite and his gi went, because back in the day, you know, they use that stuff on Hollywood. You know, it's like a liquid. You can put it out. You know, it's not really, it's flammable, but you can put it out.
Right.
Like Sterno.
Richie used fucking gas. So he poured gas on the fucking granite, right? And then when he fucking whacked it with his fist, his gi caught on fire, right?
Oh, no.
And it was all the flames on the car. And all his students came over and they were fucking putting them out. You see, you know? So Carson loved it, but he was like, he never had a back.
He burnt his arm.
Yeah, he burnt his arm.
Yeah, and Carson his hand, to sit there.
You talk about Greg's hand. Richie's hand used to look like this, right? Because he used to break it all the time on the ground. Every time he did that, he broke his fucking hand. So his hand was like this. So I used to go to the doctor, and the doctor would say, "Listen, are you done breaking granite?" And she goes, "No." He goes, "I'm not doing anything." He said, "So
Jimmy, tell him what to be a black belt in the American combat. What the test was?
Yeah, you had to get your fucking ass kicked.
Remember? Yeah, so remember. You have to. Yeah,
how do you know?
You remember? Because
I trained with some. They used to have set up a bar scene, right? So you would have to. They'd have like eight guys, you know, and you'd have to drink till you were drunk, and then you'd have to beat all eight guys.
Really?
They would be. Yeah. And that's how you get your black belt if you couldn't.
No wonder how Jimmy got his black belt. That's easy for him.
Yeah, because this type of training was like street fight training.
George, MMA. You used to have another. He used to have a club in Lynbrook. That's the Goals now. So yeah. The Goal was a Goals gym in Lynbrook. And then he had the one over in Huntington, the Rabs. And one time there was this tall guy. He was a real wise ass. He was training in the dojo, and he was just he was a big fucking kid, though. And so what happened was one of the instructors called up Lynbrook, and Johnny Squadrito came down there.
Oh,
right?
Squadrito.
Yeah,
oh,
Squadrito, yeah.
He was like
who's that?
He was like a Joe Pesci, right?
This fucking guy. He was like, if you unleash Squadrito, I don't care how many people were there. If you unleash Johnny Squadrito, he was taking them all out, man.
He was like Joe Pesci.
He went. He had a fight with his girlfriend at some department store, and some guys tried to intervene. He beat the shit out of everybody in the department store. He went to jail and everything for that. So anyway, make a long story short, this guy, they call Squadrito down. Because this big guy was being a real fucking jerk off, right? So Squadrito came down and they paired him up, and Squadrito bounced this fucking guy up and down the dojo, man. I was there. I actually felt sorry for the guy. Fucking ass whipped, man, you know? Because that was a hard style, American combat.
Yeah, it was no joke. It was what a Green Beret or a Navy SEAL would learn, you know.
I don't know if you remember Dave Hammers, that big club in
Hammerhead. They used to work
Richie used to. That's where Harry got a shot. You know,
yeah.
There, no, that was. There was something else. It was called something else then. Chevy's.
Uncle Sam's.
No, but it was Hammerhead.
Chevy's was where.
I remember Hammerhead.
They might have changed it to Chevy's, but that's where Harry got killed.
Well, I think it changed. The name changed a few times, right?
Okay. Yeah. Probably.
So anyway, make a long story short, you know, so Richie used to work there with all his students, you know, and they used to beat the shit. So one night I went there, right, and this is the first time Twisted Sister ever came out, right? And, you know, of course, I was just like, you know, out of the Marine Corps and all that, you know, and this guy's got this long hand, he's singing, and I'm in the audience going, fuck you, right?
Oh, Dee Snider was at the club?
No, they played.
Yeah, he was playing there. Oh. He was playing there.
The Hammerheads in Levittown? You were at the one in Levittown?
Yeah,
I was there.
Back in the day.
Yeah, they used to dress up like chicks.
Yeah.
And, yeah, but, dude, but I had a fight
we,
with
we didn't like
Snyder.
Them, but they liked all the girls loved them.
Oh,
so
sure, yeah.
We would go there. Oh, I had a fight
with this is when he was first coming up.
Yeah.
When he was first coming, Richie used to, they eventually had to get rid of Richie's crew because they were destroying everybody in that club. Yeah. People didn't even want to come back.
No mercy.
You know what's funny? It's hearing these stories from Jimmy when Quinny used to tell me that when they bounced together at this club in Long Island, Jimmy's night off, he used to go to the club because he could drink.
Yeah, right. For
so
free.
So Quinny would say, after two beers, you had to follow him around because he would, like, clean out the club.
Well, he learned from Richie Barathy. Now we know why, you know.
But it was funny to listen to Quinn. He said, you had to follow. You had to stop what you were doing and follow Quincy around.
You know, I got to say, with me back in the day, when I was in my 30s or whatever, you know, I was very, very aggressive. So if I went out, God forbid, I went out drinking and I had a good buzz on and somebody started it with me, I didn't think about it. Like, I didn't say, maybe I'll hit this guy. Maybe I just did it. Like, you know, to think it was to just do it. You know what I mean? I would just be all over these people. You know, it was like
one wrong word the guy would say, and that would be it.
That's why when you talked to Jimmy,
it was like you're like on eggshells. You don't know what to say.
Yeah, but you never thought about getting locked up or any of that shit.
I didn't think about it, but it did happen. But I mean, like, just one of the fans was asking me on the private messages about if, when I had a fight with like 10 bouncers back in the day in this bar. I'm not going to mention the bar, but anyway, I think I told you this guy the story, right? I took on like 9-10 bouncers, man. I was just launching them. I was just launching them. Right? Yeah, I started with my girlfriend, of course, at the time, you know, and a bottle of vodka didn't fucking help either. You know what I mean? So before you know it, we were doing front snap kicks to this fence, you know, with this other bouncer, and my girlfriend ratted me out. So all the other bouncers came over. And they wanted to throw me out, you know. And I said, I'm not going anywhere because my girlfriend was working at the time, you know. So the guy did was fucking grab me like that. Oh. That was it. Was all over, man. I was fucking with berserk, man. I ended up going with everybody. As a matter of fact, I went out. I tried to get out of the bar because there was so many of them. I tried to get out, and I looked behind me. They were coming after me. So I ripped the gate. They had like a little gate at the end of the ramp. I ripped the gate off, and I turned around and I ran back up the ramp with the gate. I just, you know, and everybody ran, and I fucking launched the gate into the fucking bar and hit the fucking bottles and shit, you know. All the cops showed up. I closed the place. I closed the place. You know, and then all the cops came, and I had this one bouncer, and I was fucking choking him out in the bushes. I wouldn't let him go. I wanted this guy so bad. I kept choking him. Right, and all the cops were behind me. It was bad. It was bad. Very bad. But, yeah, thank God I got out of that one.
Yeah. Big Rob, you ever bounced at a bar before?
Dave. Go I on. Had a fight with Mark Mendoza, the bass player of Twisted Sister, in 1979. It was June 23rd or something like that, 1979. Wow. Because my girlfriend was cheating on me with him.
Oh,
and I
really?
Told him, get up. And first of all, those guys were all fucking really tall.
Yeah.
And I kicked him. He was sitting in a chair, and I kicked him back over the chair because he wouldn't get up. And then I jumped on top of him. My girlfriend was sitting on his lap.
Oh, no.
In a club?
So I jumped on him, and I started hitting him and choking him. D. Snyder took me from behind and literally kicked my fucking ass.
Oh, really?
Punched me in the face. Dude, so bad. The bouncers came in. They smacked my head off the pipe on the outside of the club.
Oh, my God.
Dude, let me tell you something. D. Snyder, from behind, threw me a beating. I was 18 years old.
He knows how to fight. Doesn't he do martial arts, too?
I don't know, but he had me from behind. He jumped him because I was on top of Mendoza. Yeah.
He still lives here in New York, Greg. He lives down
in New York. He performed at the Olympia.
He kicked my fucking ass, bro. Yeah. He kicked my ass. I got
to
be honest
with you. We used to go, you know, he has the defense, the cold finger run. He does the, you know, if you hear that, it's a big bike run for like cancer.
He's actually not a bad guy because then, you know, everything.
No, he's not a bad guy.
I met him later on again and everything was cool, but. I didn't even get a chance to fight him. He got me from behind, but he kicked my fucking ass.
He's a tall guy though, right? He's a big guy.
Yeah, he's fucking huge. He's like 6'5" or whatever the fuck he is. He's tall.
Yeah, he's tall. He's thin though. He's thin though. Yeah.
Yeah, he's thin. But Jimmy, I was 8. He got me from behind, so I didn't even have a chance to fight him. Like, he just put me at me in a headlock. He was fucking hitting
Greg's
me.
Greg's claimed the flame. Greg's been beaten up by more celebrities than any person I know.
You know, I gotta say something, Greg. You know how I met before I met Richie Barrett? I met one of his guys. This guy Romeo. You might know him, George. Yeah. And. Yeah, so he used to work at this bar, Garbo's. It was a real drinking hole. That's all it was just a drinking hole, right? So I used to go there every weekend. We used to get trashed, you know what I mean? This is when I was in my career, too, doing all this shit, right? So I might have told you, so I don't know. So I ended up going into the bathroom. I don't know what happened. It was a bunch of my friends, right? And I walk in, and I'm at the urinal against the wall, you know, I'm doing my thing. And this guy comes in with a top hat on, and he stands next to me. He's going to go pee in the urinal next to me, right? And all of a sudden, he's peeing in the urinal, and he turns around and he pees on my leg, right?
What?
He's like peeing on my fucking leg, right?
I think you heard this. Yeah.
Yeah, I told you that, right? Yeah.
I love this story.
Standing there holding my chazole, and he's peeing on my leg, and I look at the guy. I just took a left hook, man. Bang, man. His fucking – he went down so hard, his hat – hold it for a second. And then the hat went down, right? Then I was fucking dragging him outside. I was fucking pounding him. I got him over to one of the fucking, they had these boots, these wooden boots. I was banging his fucking head on the wooden boot. Right? All of a sudden, this guy, Romeo, jumps on the back of me like Duke, right? And he got me in his fucking martial art, fucking whatever the hell it was, right? This is before MMA and all this bullshit, right? And he got me in this lock. And so I tried to, like, push, you know, go land on top of him. I pushed down and lay, but I couldn't get rid of him. And he was just choking me out. I couldn't even breathe anymore. I was tapping out. You know, and then I finally got up. And, you know, and, you know,
that's what happened to me. I didn't have a chance to fight. I didn't have a chance.
I couldn't. I never even saw the motherfucker. Right, he came up from behind me. He got me.
Why'd the guy pee on your foot, on your leg?
He was just fucked drunk. Up. He was just, you know, whatever.
He was so drunk. John Romano, don't you notice that Jimmy has a lot of fucked up things happen to him? For a guy who's so dangerous and so angry, why do people start with him? It's like he almost attracts it.
You knew me back when I was him. I was fucking you.
You attract this stuff.
That's what I wanted to say a minute ago. We see him now. You got to remember. Back then, when Jimmy was, not only was he fucking huge, but he was stiff. He couldn't move. My mother still tells me, when my mother loved him when she met him. He was on the phone. He's on the phone like this. My mother goes, "What's wrong with his arm?"
Doesn't bend. Yeah.
That's normal.
Jimmy was, Dave?
I tell you what it was back in the day. You know what it was back in the day, bro? When you always saw a big guy, whatever, like these little guys, they, like, I don't know, they just felt compelled to challenge you or something. I don't know what comes over these.
A small guy can't lose because if you beat him, you're supposed to beat him. If he wins, no, then he's like, I beat the big guy.
Listen, no, I know these two things. These two Italian guys, never forget it. We were in this big disco club back in the day, and I was bouncing, right? And these two guys, they're two brothers, they started with each other. So I went over there, I tried to break it up. Right? So I says, "Come on, guys, shake hands." Yeah, they were bomb, man, these guys. I know these guys. They're bricklayers, the both of them. They fucking got hands like cocky. Little guys, though, right? So they go to shake each other's hands, right? And one brother pulls his other brother's hand. He bites him in the hand. So right in front of me. So all of a sudden, the other brother hits him, right? All of a sudden, before you know it, turn into a 10-man brawl, right? Now we're working our way out to the front door. The fucking bar's clearing out. There's so many people biting, right? And we squeeze through the front door, and everybody lands on the concrete sidewalk, right? Oh. It looked like a football game. Like the guy was right. So after we were on the floor, like 10 of us, we all start getting off one at a time, right? And there's the one brother on the bottom by himself, right? With his eyes all fucked up. He's laying on the concrete. I said, "This guy's dead," right? So we call the ambulance, right? So the fucking ambulance finally comes. You know, we're trying to, you know, smack him, get him to. He really hit his head hard. And 10 guys were on top of him, right? Yeah. So we finally, the ambulance comes. We help the guys get him in the ambulance, right? And here comes the brother running out of the, I don't know where he came from. And he jumps in the ambulance, and the ambulance takes him. And they're fighting in the ambulance.
Oh, no way.
In the window. They were fucking going at it in the ambulance, right? And the whole ambulance is saying, the fucking ambulance is driving away. And I'm like, holy shit, man. Fucking guys are out of your mind.
Dude, you know who's like that?
You could do that. You could get away with that shit back in the day.
You know who's like that? My boy, who's a Fox News guy, Charlie Gasparino, one of my best friends growing up. You see me and him done videos and everything.
Yeah.
But him and his brother used to fist fight all the time. And it was bad. I mean, they would fight like fucking, like two guys that hate each other. Meanwhile, they were really close. They would fight. Like wicked fights, you know.
You know, I tell you though, Greg, those little guys when I used to bounce, the little guys were the worst, man.
Oh yeah.
You know, once you start going, they used to come underneath you and hit you down the legs. And matter of fact, that night, the two brothers, when they bit each other's hands, and I tried to break it up, they attacked me. They were on each leg, and I was trying to walk. I was trying to walk out of the club like this. I had these two little Italian guys stuck to my fucking legs, and I'm trying to walk out like that. Everybody was trying to get them off me. It was like a fucking movie.
Jimmy, I hate to tell you. I hate to tell you, but I was one of those.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's like, you know, it's like unbelievable. You know, like, one time I arm wrestled some guy. He was a little guy. He was like a state champ arm wrestler, whatever. So I went into, I was at my friend's house. It was a big party, you know, and I get down on a coffee table and I said, "I'm going to cream this little motherfucker," right? And I get down on the coffee table and everybody's betting on me. "Oh, Bull's going to kill him." You know, all of a sudden this fucking guy just went boom. I'm like, "What the fuck?" I said, "Like, we got to do this again." You know, he got up again, you know, like, bam, put me down again. I'm like, holy shit, this little fuck. You know, he was a really good arm wrestler. But the little guys are the ones you got to watch out for. I'm telling you, man.
And they got something to prove, too.
I was. Yeah, Greg,
I don't know what it is.
Yeah, Greg was one of those little guys. You ever get into a barroom ball, Johnny Bravo?
You know, honestly, I always found a way to talk myself out of it. I had a lot of problems. Yeah.
Shyster as well.
Like, I remember, dude, when I first moved to Arizona, right? I moved to an area here because I didn't know nothing about Arizona. It was like a cowboy town, right? And I used to go, like, to this country bar because I liked the fucking woman that would go, right? But they were all country. And I'm from New York. I don't dress. I drank. Sometimes I would come from the gym. I would wear a tank top, go have a beer, right? These motherfucking guys would come in with their girls, right? And they'll be pissed. Like, you don't come here wearing a fucking tank top. I'm like, why? Where I come from, people go, they dress however they want. They're a cowboy. If they want to be a cowboy, they're a cowboy. If they want to be whatever style they are, we don't have no fucking problems, right? A Mexican guy overheard the conversation, and he didn't like what that guy was saying to me. He went up to the fucking guy. The guy socked him, right? Knocked him the fuck out. All of a sudden, the whole bar starts fighting with each other, right?
Yeah.
I went and hid behind the fucking bar. The bartender took me. They're like, dude, listen, you can't come in here anymore like this. You can't dress like this. Come behind. He stuffed me behind the bar. Long story short, one guy pulled a gun on him outside the fucking place. It was crazy. But I always found a way to get myself out of it, but I caused a lot of problems without me even realizing it.
You're still, wait, you're still an instigator of problems.
Wait, oh, Greg, so I got to tell you, like, I was always a negotiator, like, too. Like, when I bounced, you know, you got to be a negotiator because you can't, you know, you can't just get into a brawl, you know. So if the brawl's happening or it's about to happen, you know, you have to go over there and try to negotiate, you know, calm these guys down, buy them a beer, you know, schmooze it out. You know, that's really what a bouncer's supposed to do, not drag, beat the shit out of a guy, you know what I mean? But one night there was I was in the strip bar working, right? And it was a group of Suffolk County cops came in and a group of Nassau County. They were having a bachelor parties on both sides, you know, different guys, right? So music's loud. You really can't hear in those clubs. The music's so fucking loud. You got to scream in somebody's ear to fucking, you know, get a conversation. So anyway, I don't know. The two cops started in with each other, one from Suffolk County, one from Nassau County, right? So my boss comes over and he's like, Jimmy, please go do something. Please help me. He goes, there's 15 guys over there, 15 guys. I said, all right, take it easy. So I went over there and I got in the middle of them. I broke it up. I said, listen. So I went over to the one guy on the Nassau County. I said, what's going on? He goes, that cocksucker, that motherfucker. I'll kill that motherfucker. I said, all right, take it easy. Hold on. Let me go talk to that guy. And then I went over to the other guy in Suffolk County. I said, what happened? That cocksucker, I killed. Oh, fuck. I said, listen, man. The guy just said he's apologizing. He you know, he's sorry. It was, you know, I said, he goes, he did. I said, yeah, hold on a minute. Hold on. And I go over to the other guy. I go, I, you know, he just buy, said, listen, before you know it, I had him buying a beer and everything was cool, right? And I bullshitted the both of them, you know what I'm saying?
That's like, good of you. That's nice.
Dude, yeah, you really couldn't hear anything, so, you know.
Jimmy, I'll tell you a good one. I was working in a gay bar, right? We were all the bouncers were straight. Me and my partner, Paul, Tommy Pompsello, a whole bunch of guys. And this one fucking two lovers were having a fight. And not everybody in there is a pussy, you know what I'm saying? Not every gay guy's like, swishy.
That's true. I got attacked in a gay bar. I'm going to tell you about that after.
So this big fight broke out between two guys, right? Two lovers had a fight. And the one lover was swinging a belt. He pulled his belt and was swinging like this because everybody was trying to break it up. It started big melee. So I jumped in, you know, and I was like a bull. I was trying to push him out the back door. You know, the back door's got the bar. You push in, everybody goes flying out.
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah. The emergency bar. Yeah,
the door was fucking locked, Jimmy. I'm slamming him like this. And I'm pushing. But listen, so when I'm done.
That's against the law, Greg. That's supposed to be open, you know, for emergency.
I know, but I worked for these Filipino woman. She was sick in the head. To this. When I'm done, I look. And I had a gray fucking sweatshirt, and I had blood all over me. Now, this is fucking 1993, where we're starting to build powerhouse.
Oh, it's your blood?
It was my blood, thank God. I was like, oh, no, I'm dead, because I'm thinking age, you know what I mean? I'm in that fucking place.
Yeah. I didn't even know it.
I was getting hit in the fuck. I was getting punched in the face. I had a big gash over my eye. I didn't even know it, you know what I mean? Did you ever get hit? You didn't even know? Like, later on, you're like, wait a minute, I got hit? What the fuck? Where was, you know? But it was blood all over, and I'm thinking, oh, fuck, I'm done, because I got one of these fucking gay guys' blood on me. And back in 1993, you were, like, paranoid about AIDS, you know?
But, you know, back in the 90s, I met my girlfriend, you know, years ago. She used to work in the gay bars and all that. So one night, you know, I first met her.
Is that Rita?
Said, come on.
I was going to ask, why are you in the gay bar anyway?
Go ahead,
I'm sorry.
Who are you asking that? Greg or me?
No, John asked something. I don't know what he asked.
No, I was saying, the drinks are cheap. Why you were in the gay bar to begin with.
His girlfriend worked there.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Oh, me you talking to?
Yeah.
So what happened was the girl I met back years ago, you know, when I got a date with her, she used to work in those clubs. So she, one night we were out, and she says, come on, let's go, you know, go to the club I used to work at. She knew we were everybody there. That's why we went there. I was like, all right. She said, it's a gay club. And I said, all right, no big deal. You know, we're living, let live, whatever. So I went there with her, you know, and we're hanging out drinking, and there was a lot of men there, of course. And so I had to go to the bathroom. So I says, yo, D, I'm right back. I got to take a leak. So I went in the bathroom, and I'm pissing. And I turn around. There's like five guys there staring at me, right? And all of a sudden, they start, like, coming over to me. And they're like, rubbing me up and shit. I'm like, oh, guys. I said, look, I ain't like that, man. I said, what are you doing here, then? I said, I just came here with my girlfriend, man. I was like, you know, they're rubbing my leg. All of a sudden, I was like, they're all over me. I'm getting nervous now. I'm like, either I got to start beating the shit out of people, or I got to try to get out of this peacefully. All of a sudden, my girlfriend came in the fucking bathroom, and she grabbed me. That gun, she saved me. But I was like, I was, that's the first time in my life I was actually nervous. You know what I'm saying?
You know, that's because in a gay bar, they want the straight people, like, you know, a lot of the bar, everybody's straight, because they didn't want you fucking mingling with the gay, you know what I mean? Like, all the bouncers and everything. I could tell you, oh my God, I could tell you crazy stories, you know? You know Tommy Pompasello, right? He used to spit on him. They'd be turning around, he'd be like, this
is Greg, who was that? What was that place? Believe it or not, I'm gonna mention his name. I'm not gonna say anything bad about him, but me and Quinn used to go to his health club in Manhattan down the basement. That guy owned it with the little guy with the BA. What the fuck is his name?
Frenchie? Frenchie. Frenchie.
Who?
Frenchie.
No, he sold the place. He used to have
Barton. Not Barton. No.
It wasn't fuck Frenchie's gym?
He used to go to you know, Bev's shows all the time. I don't know if he was gay, but he had like a...
No, wait.
I thought it was Frenchie's.
Short guy, ponytail. You know, he had a ponytail short.
Oh, no, you're not talking about Brian Moss.
Yeah, Brian Moss.
Brian's a good friend of mine. He used to be...
Better bodies.
Better bodies. Yeah. Right. So Quinn had this gay. Fucking... Huh?
He wasn't gay.
No, I didn't say he was gay. So me and Quinn decided, because me and Quinn, we used to go hit like 15 fucking gyms, you know, because we didn't, you know, you get bored at the same fucking gym. Right. And we trained very hard. So we used to bounce around because we like legs over there. We used to like shoulders over there, you know, back at that gym, you know. So that's what we did. Yeah, right. So we were in the city, and he said, because we used to train at Vinny's place too. Vinny had a club there. What's his name? Vinny. He had another. Anyway, so we go to this place, Better Bodies, right? And we go downstairs, bro. It was dark down there, and they had like tables with like chandeliers on them,
couch,
and shit, you know. Your couches, right?
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, I'm like, yo, what kind of fucking gym is this, man? This looks like a swing club. This doesn't look like no fucking.
That's
gym,
why he designed it that way.
When after Brian sold it and Tommy Marinelli bought it.
Yep. Yeah.
He used to have a DJ spinning down there for like 2 hours a night.
I've been there when they had that.
I couldn't take it. It was too dark.
But you know what?
It was fucking dark.
I like it bright, too dark.
When you came in that gym,
there's a lot of gays there, too. A lot.
I was just going to.
South Village. It was on 19th Street.
So right, let's yeah, go ahead, Jimmy.
When you came in, the gym was in the basement. You came in on the street level, right?
Yes.
And you had to go down the stairs. Right.
Yes.
Treacherous stairs, by the way. Yeah.
Dude, all the signatures
I'm still
on the
friends
wall.
Of Brian Moss.
How can you hear what I'm saying when you're talking? When you go into the gym and you go down the stairs, is that wall on the left with everybody's signature on it?
Right.
Yes.
Did you sign it? Who signed that wall?
I signed it, so did Quinn.
I signed it. Greg, you had to have signed it.
Oh, I signed it. Well, I'm good friends with Brian still to this day. You know, he was with Gladys Portugal.
I like Brian. Brian was a cool guy.
I think they're back together.
She left Brian to go with Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Jean-Claude Van Damme.
They're back together,
I think, right? So let me just finish my story.
Hold on a minute. So I go down to the club we decided to train here, fuck it. Even though it looked like a, you know, a swing club, nightclub, dark, you know, furniture all over. I'll never forget it, man. I never went back. So this guy was doing cable crossovers. He was a big dude and he had white spandex pants on, right? With cowboy boots. And I'm behind him and he grabs the cable crossovers, right? And he's bending over and he's doing his cable crossovers, right, with these white spandex, right? And I noticed a brown slither
down in the middle of the park,
you know, as he was doing it. And I said to Quinn, I said, look, man, his ass juice is leaking out. The guy got fucking pounded in his ass a little too much, bro. I said, he can't even hold the juice back anymore. And I mean, I, that I was it for me, man. I couldn't go back.
That place is crazy. Yeah.
But people were in the corner in the dark and shit over there. You don't know what the fuck is going on. That place looked like fucking Satan's Den, bro. Every time you turn around, there's two guys in the corner in the dark. I'm like, God, this is creepy shit, man. I really can't. You know,
do you remember Plato's Retreat back in the fucking 70s?
I went there.
Plato's Retreat.
It was a gay bathhouse.
No, it
wasn't. How about La Trapeze?
Swingers.
You ever go to La Trapeze?
Yeah, La Trapeze is a fucking S&M, like, little.
Yeah, I went there, too.
There's a guy here. His name is Sharky. Sharky owned a swing club back around the 60s, 70s.
La Trapeze.
Where Sinatra and all those, the New York Yankee baseball players used to hang out, because he's got pictures up at the bagel store here with him with all the celebrities. This guy is 91. He's still alive. He owned the swing club. He said that it was like the hottest club back in the day. That's, I think, before your time,
man. Let me tell you something, Dave. When I went
Manhattan someplace.
Times Square, probably.
I don't know where. Name was Sharky. Big nose.
Greg, when I first went to Le Trapeze, I went with a girlfriend of mine back in the day, right? And she said, you know, we said, well, fuck it, we'll go to this fucking swing club, right? So you got to go there with a girl, you know what I mean? So girls could go in there by themselves, but if a guy goes, you have to have a woman with you, right?
Yes.
So anyway,
I
never figured. I walk in, I go in the locker room, you know, and I get undressed. I got my little towel on, and we're walking out. There's fucking people all over the place, right? One guy was on. They had like equipment. They had the girl up on the equipment, and the guy's swing. Fucking whacking her like that. Yeah, all this shit. I'm walking around. I go, where the fuck am I, man? I said, this place is like out of control. Then I finally go like to the main room, right? And all it's very dark, and all I see is like a sea of asses going like this, man. Like, a fucking ass, you know, just naked bodies. All I'm like, I said to myself, this is what fucking hell must look like. I said, this is fucking crazy.
You go right in.
I never seen anything like it, man. Then this one girl, I'll never forget, this one girl was in the middle of the floor, and guy after guy was just nailing her. God, man, and she's just like going, and just another guy, then another guy. I don't know why I'm going, holy shit.
Did you jump on that? In?
But no, I was thinking about it, but then I said, you know what? I was like, fucking 20 guys are nailing this
thing.
Like,
wait,
you know.
Jimmy,
what? Hold on. Johnny Bravo. Was that Rob's wife?
I was about to say that, dude. I was about to say it.
Hold on. God.
Just kidding, Rob. That was on
his taste. I know who won.
Dave, right. I brought Vinny Comerford. You remember Vince Comerford?
Yeah. May he rest
in peace. I brought him to fucking the vault. Oh, my God.
The vault. That's another one.
Bro,
there was the vault. There was the time. Remember, there was the anvil. There was the limelight. There was.
Well, the limelight wasn't a swing club.
That's where I got.
No. I'm just saying, all those clubs were active at that time. There was the tunnel.
Oh, forget about it.
The limelight was a cool. You know, the limelight stayed open for a fucking long time.
I used to like going there. I never forget the first time I went to the limelight. I went downstairs, right?
It was an old guy.
Yeah, it was an old church. You can still see the stained glass windows and shit like
that.
You
know,
I was
like, got in a fight with
sacrilege.
Yeah, so this guy, this dude was in the middle of the floor, John, right? He had a horse saddle on his back. A fucking horse.
Dude, I know him.
I'm not kidding. He had lights in his mouth. Like the lights were flashing in his mouth. He had a horse saddle on, strapped on, and chicks were riding him. And he's riding, he's in the club with the chicks on the side. That's when I walked in there. I go, where the fuck am I here? This place is out of control.
He used to work for those clubs. He used to be in a vault, too. He'd have a butt plug with a fucking, horsetail like this with the fucking thing on his back.
Yeah, he actually had a fucking horse saddle strapped to his fucking
and
back,
guys would
bro.
Sit on him and fucking he'd ride him
around.
Yeah,
they used to ride around in the clubs and shit, man. Fucking crazy, man.
The promoters of that club were brilliant. They came up with brilliant ideas.
What's that?
They were brilliant, the promoters of those clubs.
Oh, dude, they paid him to do that.
I know. They were the promoters that did that.
Yeah, dude.
There was always a gimmick. You know? Remember you said trapeze reminded me of a club called G.G. Barnum where they had the giant
trapeze.
That's
the trannies.
Yeah, but the giant
even
trapeze.
Even the Sound Factory had the, what it was like 2 in the morning?
Swinging from the trapeze and over the dance floor.
Oh, Greg, what was the name of that place, John?
What time was the show at the Sound Factory? When would they have the show? At 4 in the morning?
Yeah.
Dude, yeah, you get to the sound. We used to get to the sound factory for 5.
But they had a show that would take place. I don't even know what time it was. 4 or 5 in the morning, something like that, yep. Right?
Late.
Yeah, it
was. John, you were talking about trapeze. I remember going into a club. It was a very, very big club in Manhattan, and there used to be, you know, the chicks used to swing on the trapeze, yep. Above the, you know,
called Gigi Barnum.
Gigi Barnum.
No, there was another club. Had another name. Was these stockbrokers. I know the story. Like these stockbrokers, they had a lot of money, and they bought this club to lose money, right? Like a bad investment.
Yeah.
And the place took off. The place took off like crazy, right? They were making mad money over there, right?
You know. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
Wait, where was it? Was it in the 20s? Was it in the 20s? Do you remember where it was? Was it in the
20s? Yeah, I can't believe. I mentioned the name.
Original Sound Factory. Because that place was crazy, and you know that was nutty. You know, what I mean, it had trapezes and fucking people swinging and all kinds of
shit. Yeah, had the fucking girls swinging on it.
All right, we have 30 seconds left to go. Can Rob talk now, John Romano?
He talked. He's spoken.
All right, 30 seconds, Rob. What do you got going on?
Okay, had a question, Dave. Now the ultrasound on my torn pec, is it a big deal?
Ultrasound.
Yes,
I think it's good.
You're gonna die in 2 days.
Wait. Can I still work out, Dave?
Out of time. Sorry.
Out of time.
Okay.
What a fucking stupid question that was.
What do you want me to do?
Waste the fucking 30 seconds. Fucking. That's the dumbest thing I fucking heard all day.
What do you want me to do? Talk about sex?
No, I don't want you to do fucking nothing. I just want you to just. I don't even want you here at all. So.
That's
no.
Dave's decision. I'm sorry, John.
You must have something on Dave that he keeps you around.
No,
I'm just going to fucking keep you quiet.
Rob, you know what? Dave said that your wife was
Who here other than Greg?
What about your mom, John?
Who reads the comments?
Dave
on our
said
show.
That your wife was in that club getting the train ran out.
And Cassidy told me your dad cheats on your mom.
I said I was just kidding. Pull up Rob's YouTube channel. Big Rob
said. What the fuck? You gave him 30 seconds. He's taking over the fucking show.
Yeah, but your dad's
You're done. Fucking enough. You're a whipping post. You're not even fucking allowed to talk. That's it.
All right.
I don't need you to talk anymore, John.
I'm pulling up your.
That's it.
I'm pulling up your
enough.
YouTube channel here, Big Rob. What do you got up on there? What's the latest video?
My Big Rob TV. The only thing I have is I did a highlight of the Planet Fitness ones.
Okay.
Planet Fitness videos, like you kind of told me to, Dave. Like you know,
you've been getting some. You've been getting some views. How many views has he got on those videos there? Let me look. Let me see.
My last one is 4,000. I think.
Absolutely.
Are you getting some hits?
You're
doing good. Look, you know what? I want everyone to be able to build their own business. That's fine. And if we break his balls a little bit, that's okay. He understands.
Thank you. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
No, we always have to have a whipping ball.
But Rob,
I wish you could bring us food like Diego used to do.
Huh? Jimmy, you remind me of my father, and that's why you get me going so good, because you remind me of my dad. My dad grew up in Brooklyn. So
his dad was a very successful businessman. You should have only been successful.
So what are you saying? Your dad used to break your chops once in a while?
Dude, I was known in the house as asshole. That's what my father referred me as. You're the asshole. Hey, asshole, come here. Hey, asshole, go take the garbage.
Where in Brooklyn?
That's abuse.
By Coney Island.
Oh, that's where I was when I was a kid.
Yeah, my dad used to work
on McDonald Avenue. That's Bensonhurst. That's what you're talking about.
Dude, you probably know my dad. My dad used to work in all the delis out down there. That's how
he learned. I still have family there on Avenue U.
Yeah, that's how my dad learned the deli business, is because he used to work there pretending he was Jewish.
Yeah, John comes from a wealthy family, and his mom still supports him.
I wish she did.
So we're going to bury the hatchet right here, John. All right.
Yeah, 100%. 100%.
All right.
Okay.
I'm 100%.
All my respect.
All right, good.
Hey, Jimmy, thanks for the stories, man. You made me feel good today. Yeah. Boy, those are
some good stories.
Back
to you.
All those fucking clubs and shit. I feel like going to fucking.
I got to tell you, Greg, nothing. And John, you know, those days were fucking hands down the best fucking days ever, man. Yeah. I mean.
We got it. Next show, Jimmy, we got to talk about our trip to D.C.
Yeah. When we assaulted all the monuments.
Rob left.
2 o'clock in the morning. I think 2 o'clock in the morning, Jimmy and I are cruising the streets of D.C. in a white Lincoln Town Car that we rented. And we're going to all the monuments, the Lincoln Monument. Drunk off our fucking ass. And they got a chain link fence that we're doing construction. We're climbing the fence. We're going inside. Jimmy's getting his picture taken with Abe Lincoln. He climbed up on the fucking chair.
You too. You got pictures with Abe Lincoln too. So I got to ask you, how did we end up with Steve Reeves? That's puzzling. bodybuilding me. I don't know how we ended up.
Because Fairfax Hackley brought us out there to do it in Mr. America. You IMC'd it, and you did the strength show. Remember, I MC'd your show too. Hack brought us out, and he brought what's his name, Tarzan, with him.
Steve Reeves.
And he brought us to the fucking White House, and and Hercules, and we're two other guys. We're walking around in the White House getting the fucking tour, you know.
Fairfax Hackley always has the good connections.
We just missed the president too, because when we were coming out of the White House, I think Bush the president at that time. Who was the president?
Clinton was. Or maybe earlier than that.
Yeah, I think it was earlier. Clinton. I remember we were walking.
Jimmy went to the bathroom in the White House, and Clinton was getting a blowjob in the bathroom, and Jimmy's like, "Oh, excuse me." Yeah.
It had to be. It was
Are you kidding me? I took a piss on Lincoln when I was there. I don't know if John got a picture of that.
Steve Reeves is a big guy.
You sure you're a Marine, Jimmy? You're desecrating the American monument.
Yes, how did we get lucky enough to get rid of Rob? This is awesome.
John, I was just about to say, I think you pissed him off. Rob is gone right now. I think Dave pissed him off too. Yeah. Dave, he's coming after you now. You said everyone was running a train on his wife.
He did say that, Dave. Yep.
He's coming after Dave next.
Johnny, I got to tell you, Dave sits there and he's nice and diplomatic and quiet. And, you know, he asks, you know, probing questions and whatever. But he's a fucking troublemaker. Because
he is.
Of course, he is.
You know what it is about Dave? John, he knows how to do it subtly. Somehow, with his diplomatic mannerism, he sneaks it in there somehow, and it ignites a fucking fire. He's really good at that shit.
He's very good at it.
I know how to push your buttons, that's why.
On the show, and Dave nicknamed Aaron Singerman Chewbacca.
I remember.
And Singerman fucking hated it. He hated it. He didn't want to be called Chewbacca. And he said to him, Dave said, "You're the fucking low man on the totem pole. You want to hang out with us? You're fucking Chewbacca and like it."
And look what I turned him into. Look what he became.
Now he's in fucking
great fucking job.
He became a multimillionaire, and now he's in jail. So I don't know. What are you going to do?
I got to ask one question, Dave. Yeah. I'm puzzled about. I know that Chewbacca went to jail, but what did he actually do? What did he actually? I never knew what he actually.
They were changing labels, supplement fact panel labels, and they were selling ingredients that were illegal that should have been illegal, but they changed the names on the labels and on the I guess the import documents. So they were defrauding people basically.
Was it pro hormones, Dave?
There was the pro hormones. Yeah, they were changing.
Yeah, but people were getting results, weren't they?
Yeah, but you can't sell, if I sell you Deca, of course you're going to get results, right? If I sell you Adderall, you're going to get results. But if they're illegal and I'm saying that the Adderall is actually vitamin Dave, C, you can't do that.
Remember hot stuff back in the day?
Yeah.
He was putting that shit in the methyl.
He did.
Yes, he did.
I heard that wasn't true, that there was no methyl. No, it was, John.
He almost went to jail. Thank God he had lawyers and shit, but he had to redo the product sucked after that.
Yeah.
Everybody was growing on that shit.
Yeah.
I'll never forget one thing, the gas that I got from
Oh my God, the gas was terrible.
What the fuck was that? I never forget. I went to the movie theater with my girlfriend, and I'm sitting there. I just took the hot stuff a couple hours ago, and I'm sitting in the movie theater, and I had to take this froth from hell. Right? I'm sitting in the chair. I said, I can't hold it. I can't take this, man. So I had to let it go, and man, it smelled like fucking dead duck and all this other shit. And like
I was in med school at the time in a big hall with like 150 people. I used to have to walk outside it and let it go.
Yeah, so, but what made you fall? I mean, that shit was like fucking gaseous.
You know why? He mixed everything together. He spiked it with methyl test. The first batch was spiked. Then after that, it wasn't spiked. So people were taking it like, I'm not making the gains I used to make. Because he did it to get everybody hooked on it. Right. And it worked. You know what I'm saying? But that shit was a mixture of everything. He threw everything in the kitchen sink.
There was every ingredient in there. You're right.
Yeah. And that's why.
I tell you, I was using it myself because I was getting gains on it too. And I was like, this stuff is fucking great. But the gas problem, you know what I mean? But that whole thing went to shit anyway when I did the whole thing with him.
The funny thing was people were accusing me of taking steroids and I wasn't. I'm like, I'm not taking anything. They're like, you look like you're taking testosterone. I said, I'm not, and I wasn't taking anything. I didn't even know about steroids then. But I was using the hot stuff. Yeah, there might have been steroids in there for all I know.
Yeah, that stuff was unbelievable. And who married his daughter? Tim Melcap?
Belknap married his daughter? Oh, I didn't know that.
What? No, I don't know. He was a diabetic, that guy.
Yeah. Yep. Huh? He was a pro bodybuilder. Yeah. Tim Belknap.
Yeah. Yeah, I think he ended up marrying Tom's
daughter. He actually bred boa constrictors too for a long time.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right, we got to wrap this show up. I guess Big Rob left us.
Thanks for getting rid of him.
He lost his. I was giving him his 2 minutes of fame, and he didn't want to take it. I don't know.
Except you know what's happening right now. He's probably feverishly making videos.
Yeah, that's what I said.
No, I think he probably had to go or something like that. I don't.
You better watch out, John, because Rob's the type of guy.
You'll takes a lot more abuse.
You'll come home one night from fucking work late at night. He'll be outside with a hockey mask on, waiting for you.
Hey, he was wearing a hockey shirt.
He knows we're only breaking his balls. I bet he had to go. It's late. I'm missing another interview I'm doing here. I got to hang up with you guys.
Fucking serious.
All right. Thanks all for you joining us. Jimmy the Bull, we're very happy you're back. And thanks for the great stories and Greg sharing all those memories today. Yeah. We're out of time. Until next week, guys, don't go to jail.
So, Jimmy, I heard you were still a virgin.
You did not repeat that information to anybody.
I can't say that I'm too surprised. I mean, just look at you.
I fucking hate your fucking guts.
Yay, loser.
What the fuck? I built this thing from the ground up, you fucking whore. 15 years ago, I divorced your fucking ugly ass.
Go buy more videos, Jimmy.
I ain't paying the rest of the fucking money to shove it up your fucking ass.